So welcome to this course on artificial intelligence and machine learning. In fact, this student training course on artificial intelligence and machine learning is being organized under the directive of NPIU, that is National Project Implementation Unit. And we have got the active support from TechEd3 of Jadavpur University. Now, first of all, I would like to express my sincere thanks and gratitude to our Honorable Pro Vice Chancellor Sir, Professor Chiranjeev Bhattacharya, who is the TechEd coordinator of Jadavpur University. I would also like to express my sincere thanks to Professor Sudipto De of Mechanical Engineering Department, who is the academic nodal of TechEd3. And thanks to all the faculty members associated with TechEd3 and the staff members. And last but not the least, I would like to express my thanks to my department and my colleagues. Now to start with, I can tell you that this particular topic, this artificial intelligence and machine learning, is one of the emergent topics which have been identified by NPIU for the student training in future skill technologies. Now, while going through the participants list in the last day, in fact yesterday, I have found that the students from different background, almost around 280 candidates, they have applied for the registration. And I have seen that out of these 250 candidates, almost more than 50% are from non-electrical background. That means in this particular group, we have students from the mechanical engineering department, we have students from civil engineering department, from chemical engineering department, from production, hopefully from food technology, metallurgy. So who belong to the non-electrical science group? So we have also the printing engineering department. And apart from that, this course is being also registered by several electrical science people, students from electronics and telecommunications, students from computer science engineering. We have students from information technology and from my own department, instrumentation electronics. Moreover, I have found that the students are from different degrees. That means the students are from undergraduate, either undergraduate 2, second year students, or third year, or final year undergraduate students. We have students from postgraduate, the first year, or a second year of the study. So which means that this particular course is being appreciated by a wide range of students. As a matter of fact, I would like to deliver the discussion on a very basic level. In fact, this particular topic, AI and ML, is a core subject of computer science people. And I believe that the students from computer science or information technology, they have already gone through this course in any of their paper in the undergraduate or postgraduate course, postgraduate curriculum. So for them, this course may not be a new one. However, the students from the other departments like civil, mechanical, production, printing, so for them maybe this is a new course. So we have heard a lot about this this artificial intelligence and machine learning. If you open a newspaper today, or if you open a TV, in internet, everywhere, we hear about this artificial intelligence and machine learning. And as a matter of fact, there has been a significant enhancement of interest amongst the common people, not only amongst the engineers, not only amongst the scientists, even the common people, those who are from the other backgrounds, maybe from science background, maybe from social science background, they might be having equal importance or equal interest in knowing the subject. So that's why the population today in this particular training course is so versatile. We have students from every department, almost every department under me. And I have also found that there are students from several schools, like education technology. I have found some people from water resource engineering as well. So this entire training course is divided in 10 lectures. So we have our deliberations in 5 days. So perhaps you know the schedule of this particular training course. If it is not known to you, then I'm going to share it with you. So in the first half, hopefully I'll be arranging one lecture from 10 to 1. And in the second half, there'll be another lecture from 2 to 5. So in 5 days, we'll be arranging altogether 10 lectures. Now, while delivering those lectures, as I've already mentioned, it might be very silly to some of you who have already learned about AI and ML in their normal curriculum, and maybe a new one to some people for whom the subject is new. So that's why I have planned to keep this presentation, keep this training at a very basic level so that it can be understood by most of you. As you know, as a teacher, as an instructor, our objective is to reach to the maximum number of people. So keeping this in mind, let me start the first lecture on this series, on this training course on AI and ML. And the first lecture is on history of artificial intelligence. Now, to start with, if I look at the term intelligence, what do you mean by intelligence? In one word, I cannot describe this one. Rather, I can say that intelligence is a kind of attribute possessed by any entity. So right now, I am not going into the debate whether this entity is a living entity or non-living entity. The only thing what I can say right at this moment is intelligence is a kind of attribute which is possessed by any entity. Now, what type of attribute it is? Is it a quantitative attribute or qualitative attribute? But as you have the idea, what is made by a quantitative attribute and qualitative attribute? Something which I can measure perfectly. That means if I can quantize something, so I can always assign some score against this. For example, if I have an object with me, it's a rectangular object. So I can always assign the dimension of this object. I can find out what is the length, what is the height, what is the width of this particular object, what is the cross-sectional area, what about the volume. I can measure this one by means of some instruments. For human being, I can always measure the height of any person, the weight of any person by some tools. So since they are measurable by some means, so these quantities are known as the quantitative, because I can always quantify this one. Now, coming back to intelligence, do you really think that intelligence can be measured? Somebody may argue that, okay, we have very famous tests like IQ test, intelligence quotient. IQ test, by means of which I can measure the intelligence of any person. Now let's think in a different way. Suppose in an IQ test, someone has framed, say, 100 questions, maybe 100 MCQ type of questions. So there are four options, and there is one correct answer. And you have to tick that particular correct answer to get the full marks. Now assume that in a particular population, there is one fellow who is aware of all the correct answers. So the intelligent quotient of that person should be the maximum one because he knows all the correct answer. But suppose that this person wants that his or her intelligence is not at all reflected to the population. In other words, I can say that this person is trying to hide his intelligence. Then what he does, even if knowing all the answers, rather all the correct answers, that particular fellow intentionally may put tick against the wrong option. What we have ultimately at the end of the day, we find that out of 100 questions, suppose that particular fellow who knows all the answers correctly, he has got say 10% marks. Out of 100, he has got 10, or he has got 15. So what we might say? We might say that, okay, no, since the marks obtained by that particular fellow is only 15, so he's not that at all intelligent. Because the IQ test says that the performance of that particular person is not at all good. Although the reality is, that fellow knows everything, but intentionally, he hides his intelligence. So this is an extreme example which can give you some notion that this IQ test and intelligence cannot be mapped directly. Even if I possess some intelligence, but that particular intelligence might not be reflected properly in an IQ test. So I can say that intelligence is a kind of attribute which is not at all quantitative. Even if some people prefer IQ test for the calculation, for the evaluation, but that evaluation is not at all perfect. It's not at all foolproof. So it's a qualitative attribute. If it is a qualitative attribute, then obviously I cannot say that whether this attribute is possessed by these people or that people, or how much is possessed by these people or that people, and what is the degree of possession, because it's a qualitative one. In other words, I can say that it's not at all absolute, rather it's relative. Let me tell you another story, or rather another event. For example, suppose in the class, we normally find that there are some people who have studied better than the other, and that is true everywhere. Might be the teacher asks some questions in the class, some tricky question in the class, and might be within the population of 50 students or 60 students, there are two or three students who might be able to give the correct answer properly and quickly as well. What is the perception of the teacher? Teacher feels that no, that particular student is very much intelligent because he gives all the right answer in right time. But the notion is different. It may be that that particular student has already gone through this paper before attending the class. And that's why he has given the correct answer. There is nothing about intelligence in it. In other words, suppose I give or I pose a question of say class 5 standard, a sum of class 5 standard, and I give it to a boy who is studying in class 4. Now, if that boy is advanced enough, that means being in class 4, if he can solve some of the sums of class 5, then it is quite possible that that particular boy is able to give me the answer, give me the right answer to a question which normally belongs to class 5, standard 5, but being at class 4, he can answer the question. So what do you feel? Oh no, that boy is very intelligent. But being at class 5, if the same boy answers the same question, it is quite natural. Oh, he is in the class 5 and I have asked some question from class 5. So it's quite expected, no, that he'll be giving me the answer, right answer. So whenever that boy gives me the answer 1 year back, that fellow seems to be an intelligent boy. If he gives me the same answer after 1 year, then that fellow is seemingly not that intelligent as was thought before. So intelligence is also a function of time, is a function of perception. In fact, in most of the books on artificial intelligence and machine learning, you'll find that, and it is a practice over the years to associate the term intelligence with people, with human being. And it was thought that this artificial intelligence is a branch of engineering, is a branch of computer science, which emulates the human intelligence on machines. So poor human, they always think that the intelligence is the only property, is the only attribute possessed by them only. Somebody might argue that there could have been some other creatures on the world who might be even more intelligent than human being. But mostly, this is our practice to associate the term intelligence to human being only. Although this is not true always. So to start today's lecture, let me allow you to go to the decade of 1940s. When the Second World War has just stopped. And we have the first programmable electronic general purpose computer, digital computer, named as ENIAC. The electronic numerical integrated computer. So many of you might have seen this picture during the course. The first digital computer, general purpose computer, was as big as a room itself. So the task was completed in 1945. And then from 1946 onwards, this machine, this ENIAC, was used mainly for computation purpose. So during that time, the computer means a machine which can compute only. And even before that, during 1930s or 1940s, during that time, NASA has recruited several female scientists, mathematicians basically, who are told to be human computer. So you might be wondering, human computer. So now we understand what is meant by computer. We have a CRT computer. In our college days, we have seen the CRT was known to be a computer. Then we have an LED screen. Now computer, from desktop to we have a laptop, tablet, laptop, and now within a smartphone, we have all the features of a computer. But think of that situation, almost 70 to 80 years back, when the computer was as big as a room. And even before that, in 1930s or 1940s, there was no digital computer. We have human computer. So what do you mean by computer? The computer, that time in 1930s or 1940s, it was a designation. Now we have some designation today. We have lecturer, we have a professor, we have scientist, we have doctor, lawyer. So we have different profession right now, different designation. So before Second World War, during that time, the computer was a kind of designation. For those people, for those mathematicians who can perform rigorous mathematics hours after hours. So NASA had recruited those mathematicians who has got their degree in mathematics or any science papers like in physics or in mathematics or chemistry for doing this computation operation. What was the purpose that time? All the trajectory calculations were performed manually by those people, by those computers, those human computers. Now the days are gone. Today, we can do all these things by running a simple program. For mathematical computations, we don't really bother on the human being right now in this 21st century. Now, before 1950, this is thought to be the primary action of any computer, to compute something. Then in the 1950, the famous British mathematician asked a simple question in a seminar. He asked, or his statement was something like that. So to the people attending the seminar, he asked that, I propose to consider the question. What are those two questions? The questions were, can machines think? Or can machines behave intelligently? So in 1950, that was proposed, or that questions were framed by famous British mathematician named Alan Turing. And we have the famous test named after him, known as Turing test. What was that test actually? In this particular game, we have three players. We have player A, player B, player C. They are physically apart. Might be they are in three different rooms. Player A in this room, player B in this room, and player C in this room. Now, out of these three players, player A and player B, they are the actual players, and player C is the judge, just like a referee. So he was a referee, yes, he was a referee, player C. And out of player A and player B, we have one computer and we have one human responder. And player C is obviously a human being. So out of three players in this particular game, two were human being, player B and player C. In fact, player C is the judge, is the referee, and player A is a computer, the machine. Now, what is the rule of the game? This player C asks the same question to both player A and player B. So in one room we have computer as player A, in other room we have the human respondent as player B. And the answers were taken from them. Then this player C, the interrogator, has to decide whether the answer has come from player A or player B. Because when the answers are coming to the interrogator or player C, he might not know what is the source of the answer. Suppose he asks 100 questions. And obviously the answers can be represented by means of some yes, no kind of thing. Not that at all descriptive. But while getting the answers from both computer and the human responder, now if the interrogator cannot decide what is the source of the answer, whether the answer has come from player A or from player B, more than half of the times. That means half of the times, or more than half of the times, he makes a wrong decision. What I mean to say is that, suppose the actual answer has come from the computer, but to the player C or interrogator, it might be like that. He might think that the answer has come from player B or vice versa. That means the interrogator is completely confused. Now, if the situation is for more than 50% of times, the interrogator or the player C or the judge, if he cannot identify properly the source of the answer, so in that case, I can say that, or one can say that, now the computer is having some intelligence. Computers can also think independently so that it can compete well with a human responder. So given the same set of question to each of player A and player B, now when the answer has been received by the interrogator, so he cannot segregate the source of the answer, because the answer from player A and player B being almost identical. So in that case, as far as the intelligence is concerned, as far as the thinking capability is concerned, this computer and human responder may be thought to be equivalent. And that is the beginning of this particular area of science. A few years later, in the 1956, officially, AI was born. In fact, we have the furthers of the field, John McCarthy and his team. He has made this statement: we propose that a 2-month, 10-man study of artificial intelligence be carried out during the summer of 1956 at Dartmouth College in Hanover, New Hampshire. So that was his proposition, Dartmouth AI project proposal in the 1955, with a proposition that a workshop may be carried out for 2 months at Dartmouth College, New Hampshire, so that many of the problems many of the intelligent problems might be solved. And then they have first coined the term artificial intelligence. And this McCarthy and his team, they are known to be the fathers of the field. So initially, these AI researchers or AI people, they have started their journey with much more enthusiasm. They were very much optimistic about what a machine can do, what a computer can do. So they can say that, okay, the computer can do this one. Computer can do this search operation. It can do this planning. It can do this navigation. It can do all these things. And initially, they have got enormous funding from the defense agency. Because while studying any subject, you have to always understand the socio-economical structure, the political structure, or political scenario of the country or that of world in total. That time, 1950 onwards, during 50s, it was post Second World War era. So that time, most of the nations, they have invested enormous amount of money in defense. And then these people, they have come up with their own solutions. They have convinced the government that, okay, if these defense projects could be accomplished, could be carried out with the aid of some artificial kind of intelligence, which is possessed by, not by the human being, rather by some computer, if you can program it properly, then might be our chance of winning will be much more. And throughout the globe, we find that during that time, enormous amount of investment was there in the field of AI. And most of the investment was coming from the defense agency. But the thing is that initially they were very much optimist about what they can do. They have promised many things. And as a matter of fact, we have the early enthusiasm of around, say, 20 years, starting from 1952 to 69. So their claim was the computers can do X. So X can be anything. And initially, they have also provided some of the proofs. Some general problem solver was being proposed by Newell and Simon. Using some computer program, they are able to prove some of the theorem in geometry. And some perceptron kind of neural network was also proposed during that time in 1960 by Wiedenhoff, the most popular Adeline's model of neuron. I don't know whether you have any knowledge about Adeline's neuron or not. Hopefully, that might also be discussed in this particular lecture series. But the introduction or inception of this Adeline neuron or perceptron neuron was done long back in the year 1960 or 1962. So that was the era of early enthusiasm. So they can solve a lot of problems. And they have promised many. So life was good. And let us take a look at some of the milestones of AI. As I've already mentioned, in the year 1950, the Turing test was carried out for machine intelligence. And 1956, AI was born officially, the name was given officially at Dartmouth College of Workshop. And the first chatbot psychotherapist, Eliza, was there in 1964, and first general purpose mobile robot was introduced in the year 1966. So during that time, the AI was a big thing. AI was on its rise. Then came the winter. Now, what do you mean by winter? In tropical country like ours, winter is a very pleasant season for us. But you know that everything, I mean, all these nomenclatures typically made as far as the perception of the first world country is concerned. So unfortunately, the winters in first world country is not at all that pleasant like ours. So whenever we say winter, that means sudden fall down. So in fact, in the era, we have two different winters for AI. The first one was from 1974 to 80. Initially, there was a prospect of machine translation. So since the prospect was good, so many people have tried to study in this particular area of computer science, or initially it was a subject of mathematics or science. But during that time, 1974 to 1980, a number of failures was reported in machine translation. I have already mentioned that neural network was initially proposed in 1960, the long back, almost 60 years back, by Widrohoff, the underlying model or perceptron. But unfortunately, some negative result was coming while applying neural nets for solving any practical problem. Even for speech understanding, for speech recognition, all of them are not getting the desired result. And they comprise the first winter from 1974 to 1980. And the second winter came from 1987 to 1993. Decline of LISP and the decline of specialized hardware for expert systems. So these were reported. And as a matter of fact, the interest in AI has gone tremendously low. Because now people are thinking, okay, AI was not that good as it seems to be. They have started their journey, the AI researchers, they have started their journey with lot of enthusiasm, with lots of promises, with lots of optimism. But ultimately, 1970 onwards, there has been a lot of negative results reported from the different parts of the world. And as a matter of fact, some lasting effects. So if you just take a look at the statement over here, the statement was that artificial intelligence is associated with systems that have all too often failed to live up to their promises. And another statement, which I want to mention over here, I have already mentioned, some believe the word robotics actually carries a stigma that hurts a company's chances at funding. And as a matter of fact, if I take a look at this particular graph, which shows the attendance at large conferences over the period from 1984 to 2018, over a period of almost 34 years, three decades long, you'll see that from 1980s onwards, 85 onwards, there has been a significant reduction in attendance. Different types of internationally acclaimed conferences are mentioned over here, but the attendance was drastically small. It was almost like in the year 1995 or 2000 or 2005, it was very small. And after that, after 2005, there has been significant growth in the field of artificial intelligence. And 2015 onwards or 10 onwards, there has been significant rise in the attendance of large conferences. Now, what is the reason behind this? What we find from this particular diagram, from this particular graph, that after 95 or after 2000, or even after 2005, there has been a significant growth or enhanced interest came in the area of artificial intelligence. What is the reason behind this? The reason is nothing but what has happened in the year 1997, the milestone. In the 1997, perhaps you can remember, or maybe you have got some idea, and the IBM Deep Blue Computer has defeated Garry Kasparov in chess. So that was the first time a human being is being defeated in chess by a computer. Although there were several criticisms about what AI can do and what AI can't do. There has been a lot of debates and contradictory answers, contradictory statements in the field of AI. One very popular statement is that, and this is well known to all the AI researchers, that if it works, then it is not AI. So initially, when in 1997, so you understand that before 1997, already the field of AI has experienced two winters, winter one and winter two. So even after winter two, when in 1997, the IBM supercomputer Deep Blue defeated Garry Kasparov for the first time in the world of chess, then what the critics of AI, in fact, who don't take AI very seriously over the years, they have claimed that the Garry Kasparov has lost not because of artificial intelligence, but because of some brute force kind of searching as done by this Deep Blue computer. So there is nothing, there is no AI about it. So this computer has done a lot of search, brute force kind of searching to find the best option to defeat Garry Kasparov. So as I have started today's discussion initially, that intelligence is the kind of thing which is a relative one. It's not absolute at all. In the 1950 or 1960, chess was also there. And it is supposed to be played by between two human beings. Nobody can think of a situation that a computer or a machine can play a chess. Forget about the result, win or loss. Nobody can think of a situation that a computer or a machine who is not a human being, who is able to play a chess against a person, against a human being. And as you know, chess is a game which requires rigorous intelligence. So, some non-living element who doesn't possess any memory. So how can this be possible for it to play a chess? It was not at all possible. So people thought in that way, in 1950s, 1960s. This is the game which has to be played by human being only. In fact, we have some notions. And I would say that these notions are not at all correct. Although this is beyond our discussion, but I must say that once it was thought that cricket is a game which has to be played by the male players only. So now we have the women cricket team. That is true for any type of sports. So as far as the chess is concerned, people have thought initially that it is not at all possible for a machine to play a chess against a human being. Forget about the win and loss situation. And so that time it was thought that a machine, you know, it's a dull entity. It can't do anything. So that time, if I quote unquote the term intelligence, because we must appreciate, all of us must appreciate that this chess has something to do with intelligence. If you are not at all intelligent, then obviously it is not possible for you to play a chess. Because it is not possible for you to memorize each and every step in a chess. So if I use this term, quote unquote, intelligence, so that time it was thought that the machine or computer possesses zero intelligence. Might be negative intelligence if possible, one can say. Zero intelligence, because it doesn't possess any intelligence. So no matter of playing chess against a computer or against a machine. Then the situation has been changed dramatically. And 1997 is known to be the remarkable year when, for the first time, the human intelligence and the machine intelligence were comparable. And because of this comparable nature, now the Deep Blue was able to defeat Kasparov in a game of chess. It is also told that, so now you must appreciate that. Now it seems to be very difficult to defeat a computer in a chess game or any grandmaster. If he can do that, if he can succeed to defeat, that is known to be, or that is claimed to be, a triumph for them. Now he has done it. So initially what was thought, 1950s and 1960, the human intelligence, so although I am in disagreement with the statement that human is the only one creature on this world who possesses intelligence. There might be some other creatures, might be monkey, might be dolphin, might be elephant, who are even more intelligent than human being. But we, the educated one, quote unquote educated, we refer the human to be the most intelligent person or most intelligent creature in the world. So I started thinking like this way. And that time the machine intelligence was nothing, was nil, and human intelligence was dominating. Then years have passed by. 1997, there was a kind of war, a competitive kind of thing. And Deep Blue has defeated Kasparov. And now you think the machine intelligence has gone further beyond that limit. And human intelligence is maintaining at that level. And sometimes I feel that, this is my personal opinion, although, that human intelligence is reducing day by day. You can, perhaps you know the contribution in mathematics by Ramanuj. So that great mathematician calculates the difficult sum very quickly. It is not possible for us. So you might argue that no, he was a genius. So with the common people, it is not possible for us to do all these sums very quickly. However, that is my personal experience. Even for a summation between two numbers, 5 and 7, I have seen my students to use calculator for this basic sum. So 5 plus 7 is always 12, we know that. But I have found that they used to take the calculator from their bag and use it to find out the sum of 5 plus 7. Or 35 minus 19. So it requires a calculator. Anyway, so my personal opinion is that the human intelligence is reducing day by day because of this machine intelligence. Not because of the machine intelligence, rather, we are very much dependent on machine. We are not activating our brain cells. And that's why the human intelligence is reducing day by day. And on the other hand, the machine intelligence or computer intelligence is increasing day by day. So now, if there is kind of game of intelligence between a machine and a human being, it is very difficult for any human being to defeat a machine. Because the intelligence of machine, quote unquote, this intelligence of machine is much higher. Even if we cannot compute, even if we cannot quantitatively say that whether the machine is having some this amount of intelligence or that amount of intelligence. But what we can do, even I believe that everybody, every one of us, we have the Chase app in our mobile phone or smartphone. So you find that there are different levels of the game, level 1 to say level 10. Now, if you are in level 1, level 2, you'll find that you are quite happy to get a win against the machine. On the other hand, if you move to, say, level number 8 or level number 9, you find it very difficult to get a win until unless you are master. So what is happening initially? In level 1 or level 2, you are the same people. You have the same intelligence. You are playing with the machine. And you have the same machine against you. So initially, the machine is capable. That app is capable to defeat you. Now, whenever the app is in level number 10, that means whenever you are operating in level number 10 or level number 9, then you find it very difficult to get a win. But initially, in level 1 or level 2, when you are playing with the app against this computer, against this machine, you find that your success rate is 100%. So I would like to come back to the same point which I started with, that IQ test is not a good measure of intelligence. Okay, we refer IQ test as a good measure, but it is not foolproof. One can intentionally hide its intelligence. The machine is having the intelligence to defeat you 100 times out of 100 in level 9 or level 10, assuming that you are not a master in chess. But in level 1 and level 2, you are self-satisfied that, okay, no, I have won all the matches against the machine, against the computer, or the app, in this particular app. What does it mean? Does the machine possess less intelligence? If winning in a chess match is regarded as a benchmark of intelligence, does it mean that if you win at level 1, you are having the more intelligence than the machine? No. So once again, let me come back to the same point, that intelligence is the kind of thing which is always relative, not at all absolute. Almost 100 years back, it was not thought of a door who is intelligent enough. That you can always dream. Okay, I can build a house. Almost 100 years back, we are in 1921, just after the First World War, 100 years back, let us assume. And you have thought to build a home for which the doors are magical. What do you mean by magical door? That whenever somebody passes through it, then it will automatically open. And after he or she moves in, then the door automatically closes. If the situation is something like that, so it was a dream in 1920s or 1930s. Nobody can think of it. But now we know that everywhere, if not in our home, but in every auditorium, every hotels, you'll find this type of smart doors. So that time, 100 years back, it was thought to be not possible, not at all possible to have a door like this, magical door. How can this be possible? So door was not intelligent. You have to push the door, you have to pull the door to make it open or close. But this time, right now, because of the advancements of technology. So this artificial intelligence and the other parts of technology, they are shaking hands to achieve a goal. So now we know that we have sensors, we have motion sensors over there. And because of the motion sensor, one can easily implement a door like this, automatic door like this. It's quite possible. So now the beauty is that whenever you have got this particular dream to be fulfilled, so if you dreamt in 1921, so that time it was a dream, and now it is reality. It is completely reality in 2021. And even before that, not in 2021, even before that. Now, if you say that now the door is become pretty much intelligent, because if somebody enters, it opens, and if somebody moves in, then it closes accordingly. Then one might argue, in fact, the people who are the critics of AI domain, they'll say that no, there's nothing AI in it. It's all about the motion sensor. You have designed motion sensors, you have devised it properly, and you have implemented accordingly. So that's why the door is smart enough. You have smart door. There's no AI about it. And that is the biggest problem. The AI researchers, they always think that they're frustrated about this, that if somebody is being done, if it works, then it is not AI. I might argue that, okay, there is a certain kind of advancements in the other field of science and technology because of which it has become possible. But one must appreciate the effort made in the area of AI. Now, if I once again go back to the winters of AI, as you know, there are two winters in 1974 to 80 and second winter from 1987 to 1993. So what was the reason behind the shortfall? In fact, when the AI was started enthusiastically, just after the Second World War, so they have promised a lot of things. So they are very much optimist about doing so many things. So their goal was to deliver something. Because as you know, even if you don't know, I can tell you that for any project, for the project completion, it is a duty for any principal investigator to show the deliverables, whatever we have delivered. During writing any project proposal, these are some outcomes which we'd like to accomplish at the end of the project. And we have to show that, okay, at the end of the project, we are able to carry out these things. We are able to accomplish these things, these many things. Might be there are five objectives. I'm able to complete 3 out of 5, or 3.5 out of 5, and rest is still pending. So you need to deliver something. And if it is deliverable, no. So in that case, everybody will appreciate. No, I have got something, some materialistic thing. So this is the application. So AI people, initially they have started with their application. It is deliverable, fine. So lots of funding goes into the field of AI initially. But the problem is that the AI people was optimist, that is true, but they were not realist. I won't say they are pessimist, but they were not realist. They were optimist only. They claimed that, okay, we can do so many things. And sometimes they are able to do that, but there was no such solid mathematical background. And as a matter of fact, there was a kind of silent war between the AI people initially during that time, 1970s or 1980s. There is a kind of silent war between the AI people and the basic computer science researchers, the theoretical researchers. The computer science theoretical researchers, they will prove different algorithms mathematically. So they have the solid mathematical proof behind all such developments. And on the other hand, the AI people, they basically look for the application part. It might happen that with some algorithms, they have devised something which might be working properly in a particular environment. Now, if the environment changes, okay, we'll be discussing about the environment in detail in some of the future lectures in this particular course. Now, if the environment changes, it might happen that the same algorithm is not working at all. And as a matter of fact, a lot of failures were reported in the field of AI. And there came the computer science people. Now they have talked with the AI people. They have instructed what is the reason behind the failure. I believe that all of you are very much well aware of computer programming in any language, maybe in C or in Java, C++ or MATLAB, any language might be. You know that whenever you write a program for any particular algorithm, it might happen that for a set of input, it is working properly. If you change the set of input, it might not work properly. It might give you some wrong result, some undesirable result, some errors. But for the first time, for a different set of inputs, you are getting the correct result. So what was wrong in the implementation? The wrong thing in the implementation was the solid mathematical background. Might be you have written the code for a particular condition, for a particular environment, but you have not taken care of all the possible environments, all the possibilities which might arise in this particular case. So there was a handshaking between the computer science theoretical researchers and the AI people. So AI was lack of some mathematical, solid mathematical deliberations. And in fact, if I talk about, or if I just want to divide the entire range of AI, initially, it was a symbolic AI. So AI was influenced by some predicate logic. And we have, the AI people had a lot of debts from the philosophy people. So they have borrowed several concepts from philosophy. So you might argue that AI is a branch of computer science, but how can this be indebted to philosophy? Yes, that is true. Initially, before 1960, 1970, during that time, the AI was symbolic AI. That means it was basically influenced by some philosophical thought, some predicate logic. Although this provision is not there in this particular course to include the fuzzy logic, if it was there, then I can show you in detail that how this AI was initially influenced. A traditional, I should not say AI, rather traditional AI was influenced by fuzzy logic, the predicate logic. And then the concept of fuzzy was there to find out the anomalies in traditional AI, and the new field of computational intelligence was born. So after these two winters, these computer science people and the AI people, they shake their hands together. They have complemented each other. And as a matter of fact, now the field of AI, you find a lot of mathematical deliberations in it, and which makes it foolproof. So traditionally, I can divide the field of AI. Initially, it was a symbolic AI, governed by the predicate logic, a lot of philosophy. Then we have some probabilistic AI. Until 2000, probabilistic AI, mainly governed by probability and some linear algebra, obviously. And in fact, the effect of linear algebra is much more prominent afterwards with the introduction, or I should not say the term introduction, rather with the exploration of a neural network. although these neurons, basic neurons, artificial neurons, were proposed long back, as I've already mentioned, in 1960, Widrohoff's Adeline model. But the growth in the field of neural networks is very recent. For the last 15 or 20 years, you'll find a lot of applications. And that is true for every branches of this artificial intelligence. One of the components of artificial intelligence was the genetic algorithm or genetic programming. It is also told as different types of bio-inspired optimization algorithm. It is one of the objectives of AI, or one of the part of AI, bio-inspired optimization algorithm. So for search algorithm, we'll be discussing search algorithm in either second or third day of our discussion. So it is guided by some rule. However, for this bio-inspired optimization, like genetic algorithm, some particle swarm optimization, some differential evolution, so there are lots and lots of optimization algorithm, which are mainly inspired by biology. So in this particular case, AI is also indebted to biology. So there are a lot of fields. AI is indebted to biology, AI is indebted to philosophy, and it is also indebted to economics to some extent. I hope that it is not possible to discuss all these aspects in detail, but I am just telling you the basic flavor of the subject. Anyway, so if you just look at this genetic programming, or rather this evolutionary optimization technique, bio-inspired technique, the first article was proposed long back in 1975 by John Holland. Since then, there has been no such advancements or no such application of this particular optimization technique in the field of computer science or in the field of electronics or in other fields as well. Now, with the development or with the expression of computational power, now we have the machines which are very much fast as compared to the ancient machines. So computing facility has been enhanced tremendously. And then, since 1990, 30 years back, if you just open Google and if you just type the application of GA, genetic algorithm, or application of particle swarm optimization, you will find that there are lots of applications in several branches of engineering. We have applications in electronics, Roman, for antenna design, for filter design, people are taking the help of genetic algorithm. We have applications in electrical engineering department, electrical engineering specialization. We have applications in mechanical engineering, we have applications in civil engineering. In every domain, you find the applications of genetic algorithm, everywhere. A lot of researchers throughout the world, they are working with an amalgamation between the genetic algorithm and their own field. So I am taking the name of genetic algorithm for sake only. Apart from genetic algorithm, there has been a lot of optimization techniques, search techniques. But remember that these techniques, they're heuristic in nature. There is no guarantee that they will converge. Ultimately, you'll be getting a result or not. There is no guarantee. So even if we do some research in the area of, say signal processing or so, and if I take the help of any such heuristic tool, so there are two types of questions. The people, the reviewers who are traditional enough, they might ask, why have you used this particular tool for your application? You might have used some traditional technique, some traditional mathematical technique that might give you a very good result. Why to take this one? There is no such solid mathematical background behind this. Rather, the optimal solution is not at all guaranteed. So why to take this one? You might be getting this answer correctly for this time, but for the next time, you might not get the same result. And the person who are expert in this domain, they might ask, why have you taken this particular algorithm? Why not that algorithm? So there goes a constant conflict in this particular area, always. you'll find this one. However, when the computer science people, the theoretical computer science people, when they have shake hands with the traditional AI people, then the problem of AI has been solved to some extent. And now you find there has been a significant increase in demand in this particular area of computer science. Now, if I just go to the formal definition, what is meant by AI? I have just listed four such definitions. Hoglund in 1985 proposed that the exciting new effort to make computers think, machines with minds in the full literal sense. McDermott et al. In 1985, they have told that the study of mental faculties through the use of computational models. Reach and Knight in 1991, which is seemingly the most appropriate definition of AI, the study of how to make the computers do things at which at the moment people are better. I'm coming to this point afterwards, after making the statement of this one. Nielsen, 1998, he has told that computational intelligence is a study of the design of intelligent agents. So in fact, the definitions of AI, or rather the field of AI, can be divided into four different segments, considering two attributes. One is the thinking capability and the acting capability. And the second one was whether this operation is being done like a human being or rationally. So accordingly, we can have four different areas which one can think of to make it a part of AI. So one can say that AI is nothing but a system, a systems which think like a human being. Then we can have systems which think rationally. Then systems which act like a human being, and systems which act rationally. So there are basically four areas: systems which can think rationally, systems which can act rationally, systems which can act like a human being, and systems which can think like a human being. So obviously, obvious question is that why the rational things and the human beings, whether these two are apart. Are human beings not rational? So that's a separate issue of discussion. I'm not going into that. But as far as the literature is concerned, you'll find the entire field of AI has been divided into these four segments. And this statement is the most prominent one: the study of how to make the computers do things at which at the moment people are better. So that means the goal for the AI researcher is not at all fixed. The goalpost is not fixed. Take a look at this statement: the study of how to make the computers do things at which at the moment people are better. Now, prior to 1997, the task of the AI researcher was to how to defeat any human being, any grandmaster, in a game of chess. Because at that time, the human being were better in the game of chess as compared to machine, as compared to computer. But now, this has been solved. This entire thing has been solved. Now, a machine can easily defeat a human being, even a grandmaster. So now, if you claim that this is the success story today, if you open a newspaper and if you find that there is one computer developed by some agency, and that computer has defeated some of the grandmasters, so it is not a big news today. It's not a big deal today. Because, you know, in 1997, that was done. So now the AI researchers are targeting something which has not been achieved yet. That means it's a never-ending process. One cannot say that this is the goal of AI, and if it is done, then it is over. And as a matter of fact, everybody tries to associate this particular tag with AI, that if it works, it is not AI. Because the goalpost for AI is continuously updating. It is not at all constant. For example, I'm the person from communication. For example, if I go, say, 50 or 60 years back, 1950s or 1960s, during that time, all of us are having some transistor radio in our household. What was the purpose that time? The purpose is to listen to the programs which are being aired from any of the radio station, nearest radio station. So in Kolkata, we have the radio station in Gustin Place, and the programs were aired from that particular terminal. So it was a one-way communication. We can only hear, we can only listen to what has been transmitted from that particular end. So that time, if somebody says you, if somebody proposes that, okay, we might have a device with which you can communicate with your near and dear ones in 1960, you might not believe, because that was beyond the imagination. Later on, if we move to the era of 70s, 1970s, we have television first, although a black and white television initially. So apart from listening to the program, we can also watch what has been done over there. It was broadcasted, television, but still it was a one-way communication. We don't have the provision to communicate from this end. Then those radio stations, they have made the provision, this phone-in program. So now, if you have telephones, the landline telephones, you can also communicate with the radio station or the people in the radio station. And prior to that, we have landline telephones at our household with which we can communicate to the people with our near and dear ones. And that time, we have only one landline telephone in the entire household. Maybe in an entire locality, only one telephone. We have the STD booths. PCOs were there. So now it is non-existent in Kolkata. You don't find a PCO booth. It's very difficult to find because every one of us possesses a personal mobile phone, if not more, at least once. So then the days of this this telephone has gone. Now we have mobile phones. We can, initially with mobile phones, we can talk, exchange the voice, exchange messages. Now we have the mobile telephone with the net connectivity. We can transfer the information, transmit the information, we can receive the information over net. Now, through net, initially, some kind of text communication, data communication. Now we have this image, video. So you might not think this one almost 30 years or 40 years back, but now it has become possible. So same is true for AI as well. In future generation, in 5G communication, it is proposed that instead of people communicating with one another, the vehicles will communicate with one another. So one vehicle will communicate directly with another vehicle with all the facilities, GPS facility and all. So you might not think of this situation almost 50 years back. The same is true for AI. And for AI, the target is to ensure, the target is to beat the human being. Assuming that human being, they are the most intelligent person in the world. The target of AI is to beat them in whatever area they are the best. If I go back to the Turing test, which was done in 1950, it was to check that whether the human being or the machine, they possess the same level of intelligence or not. The interrogator or player C, as we have mentioned few minutes back, that interrogator is not at all capable to distinguish which one is machine and which one is a human being. And that is the success of Turing test. Obviously, there are certain limitations of Turing test. It is not at all constructive. It is not reproducible. And which are the shortfalls of traditional AI. But initially, Turing has proved that it is possible to ensure that they possess some kind of intelligence because they can think on their own. Because they possess some memory. Until and unless you have some memory, you cannot think. But now the situation has been changed drastically, and it's almost the reverse one. So that time, 1950, there was a confusion whether the machine is a human being or human being is a machine. Same question was asked to both the human being and the machine. And machine is giving an answer as equivalent to a human being. And now we have the opposite scenario. In Turing test, interrogator was a human being. And now the interrogator today, in today's world, in 21st century, in 2020-2021, another machine which we have prepared, which we have developed over the years, the computer. Now the machine asks us whether you are a machine or you are a human being. Please justify that you are not a robot. That is CAPTCHA. You need to provide that alphanumeric characters as CAPTCHA to justify that you are not a robot. And that is the irony. As I have started with, the entire thing has been changed. There has been a topsy-turvy. A complete change has taken place. Initially, the interrogator was a human being. It asked the machine whether you can answer it properly. Just like a human being. That means human being was checking the intelligence level of the machine. And now the situation has been reversed. And the machine today is asking us, please clarify whether, or please clarify that you are not a machine by putting the CAPTCHA. And that is the irony. So the intelligence level of the machine has been increasing drastically. And in my opinion, as I've already mentioned, the intelligence level of human being is reducing. So now, if you just consider the game between the human being and a machine, it's not a fair game today. So they are far away. The machine is far away from us. The robot is much more efficient than us. Anyway, so with this, I am towards the end of this lecture on the history of artificial intelligence. And in fact, we'll be discussing something about in today's lecture, in the later of today's lecture, I'll be discussing about some of the mathematical background, because as I have already mentioned, the one of the reason for pitfalls of traditional AI is that there was a lot of philosophical concept with less mathematical background. And in the second phase of AI, we have this probabilistic AI. So we'll be discussing something in the second lecture, in today's second lecture on linear algebra. And I hope that this is already well known to you. But to start with, I'll be discussing something. Hopefully this will be known to all of you, if not most of you. The linear algebra. And in the third lecture, today's third lecture, we'll be discussing about some fundamental concepts of probability, which will be used in some of the discussions of this training series. Now, with this, let me conclude this lecture.